Extreme weather and flooding are increasingly devastating communities worldwide. In fact, here at home in Bicol, and we reported this yesterday and in the past couple of hours, barely 48 hours ago, 2 months worth of rain was dumped in less than a day. With COP29 on the horizon and the Philippines hosting the Loss and Damage Fund, the issue of climate finance is more critical than ever. Joining us from Kuala Lumpur, where the Institute for Energy, Economic and Financial Analysis, or AIEFA, conference is being held for the first time in Asia, is Brad Adams, founder and executive director of Climate Rights International. Brad, good afternoon to you from Manila. Thanks for joining us today.
Hi, thank you.
All right. Before we get into the topic of climate justice, you established the Berkeley Community Law Center in the East Bay and eventually found the need to form Climate Rights International. When was it, Brad, when you realized that human rights and climate justice should not be separate and distinct from each other?
Well, it's been a gradual process. I was the Asia Director of Human Rights Watch for 20 years before I left to start this organization. And what I realized was the human rights community wasn't focusing on the biggest human rights problem of our generation, and probably, you know, our children's generation, which is climate change. We need to actually look at all the aspects in ways that climate change is affecting people, from, you know, forced displacement, major health consequences, extreme heat, problems in the workplace, you name it. Climate change is the ultimate cross-cutting human rights issue, and the human rights community just wasn't prioritizing it.
Talk to us about the road from advocacy to policy and how important it is, especially for vulnerable countries like the Philippines, to see climate justice reflected in local and national policies, Brad.
Yeah, you know, climate justice is typically seen as a global issue of making sure there's something called the just transition, for example, so that people who are working in industries related to coal or oil and gas, when they lose their jobs in those industries, are able to find new work that pays them a similar amount or more. They get retraining. But the just transition and climate justice really is about, largely about what happens to people who are suffering from climate change. So, you know, let's take people who are elderly, who are now facing more and more extreme heat. What are governments going to do for them to protect them? What are industry that's benefited from fossil fuels going to do to protect them? How is, and taking to the national level in the Philippines, how is the Philippines, which has not contributed very much to the problem of climate change, going to be compensated by the polluters? Because let's face it, climate change is a problem of pollution, polluting the atmosphere with carbon dioxide that is increasing temperatures and making life unlivable for many people around the world. So it has, you know, many elements from a local community level, what happens at a hospital or a school for children who are too hot, what kind of cooling is there for them, to what kind of huge financial transfers are going to be made to countries like the Philippines that didn't cause the problem.
Now, COP29, as you know, Brad, just around the corner, the Philippines as well, hosting the Loss and Damage Fund. With these developments, tell us about your expectations in terms of exacting climate justice from those who are ultimately accountable.
Well, this is probably one of the most complicated elements of the global climate change conversation, because loss and damage really means liability and compensation. It was the United States that refused to use the term liability and compensation, because the United States view is that liability is a legal concept. We create a legal obligation if you admitted liability. So they and other rich countries didn't want to use that term. So starting from that premise that loss and damage is about liability and compensation, we're talking about literally trillions of dollars of transfers that have to happen to make people whole for the damage they've experienced. Let's think about it in terms of a legal matter. I'm a lawyer. If I go to court and sue somebody for compensation for harm, the court should award me the full amount to compensate me for my harm. And sometimes they will award more punitive damages. That's the scale of the problem we're facing. Now, the amount of money that's being made available by wealthy countries to transfer to poor countries in loss and damage fund is tiny. It's somewhere on the scale of 1/1000th of the amount due. So the Philippines is going to have a very important role. This is a really important obligation they've taken on. Fortunately, the Philippines has been, from the outset of early climate talks, there have been some famous interventions by Philippine government officials. And we do expect the Philippines to stand up to wealthy countries and demand that they pay their fair share.
But talk to us about the roadblocks there. I mean, we all know what should happen. We do know as well that the Philippines has one of the loudest, if not the loudest voice in of vulnerable nations out there on trying to exact accountability. But there are roadblocks here. There are certain institutions that might just get in the way because of their bias to more developed countries.
Yeah, I mean, if you're referring to the World Bank, which has a major role in the loss and damage fund, I think that's something to be concerned about, because who are the shareholders of the World Bank? They are the most developed countries, the countries with the biggest economies. And naturally, they would be concerned about what their essentially what their bosses think. There's also the issue of who should pay. Now, when the Paris Agreement was signed, and farther back when the Rio Agreement was signed, the earliest climate change agreement, China was a developing country. China is now the second biggest economy in the world. It has huge cash reserves. It is now the world's biggest emitter by a factor of two, so twice as much as the United States is being emitted from China, and it's catching up to the U.S. as a historical emitter. But they say they have no obligation to provide any funds for loss and damage. They're saying that we are a developing country and we should be exempted. So there are all sorts of blockages here. You know, the U.S. Congress is full of Republicans who don't admit that climate change is real. We have Donald Trump that says climate change is a hoax. We have the rise of right-wing populist parties in Europe that are discouraging governments from putting in the amount of money they should, because Europe is also historically a huge emitter. And then we have, you know, a country like China that's saying we're going to give zero for the loss and damage fund. So yes, huge institutional blockages, but I think that the demands from people around the world are going to overcome those. The question is, how fast will they overcome them, and what happened in time to help them?
I think, and I don't know if you'd agree with me here, Brad, we've gone past the point of compromise, that it's now all about what is effective, what is equitable. And when we think of that, what should policymakers focus on?
Well, look, you know, equitability is a huge call, but it is ultimately a moral call. And we do not see a lot of states people running some of the world's biggest governments and most powerful institutions. Like, you know, the UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres has been fantastic. You know, he's basically saying, you know, we can engage in collective action or collective suicide. I think it's a very powerful statement he's made. But we don't see that kind of leadership in many countries. So I don't know we're going to win the equity argument in the short term. We have to keep fighting for it. Then you have to win the practical argument, which is that climate change is hurting all of us. We can see it around us. Now, the climate deniers, I don't even think they actually believe themselves when they deny climate change exists, because, you know, whether you live in North America or Southeast Asia or anywhere else in the world, you are experiencing all-time highs in heat, droughts, huge storms. You know, what people would consider to be once-in-a-lifetime, once-in-a-century events are happening every year now. And so people are going to be forced government leaders are going to be forced to take action, because there's really no other choice. And then the question is, how do you, and this is what this conference is about in Kuala Lumpur, that I'm at, how do you do the math on this? How do you do the economics on it to try to create incentives so people act faster than they're currently planning to do?
Which brings me to our final question, Brad. It used to be that the advocacy ran counter to business sense and the bottom line. Tell us why climate action is worth the economic and financial analysis, and how it ultimately means the survival of all, not just the vulnerable. We're talking about businesses here as well. Go ahead, Brad.
Yeah. Well, look, one of our ways of trying to make progress on human rights and climate change is to pressure businesses to actually see what's in their own best interest. So I'll give you an example. We've been working on the nickel industry in Indonesia, and we soon will in the Philippines. And it turns out that nickel for electric vehicle batteries is an essential industry for a renewable economy. The human rights consequences of the nickel industry are sometimes hard, air pollution, water pollution. But what we've been telling Tesla and VW and Hyundai and Ford and all the big auto companies is that You right now have a consumer base that is very environmentally and eco-conscious. They're very concerned about climate change. That's why they're buying electric vehicles. If our work and the work of others starts making clear to people that you are investing in a very dirty industry that's causing human rights harms, and by the way, in Indonesia, they're using coal to power the nickel industry. So you're buying a little carbon bomb if your nickel in your electric vehicle comes from Indonesia right now. If the word gets out about that, that's a terrible business model for you. So clean up your act now, get ahead of the curve. Don't be in a situation where you are being accused of being part of the problem instead of part of the solution, even though you're selling electric vehicles. And I think we can make those kind of arguments across many industries. It's just that we have to assemble the evidence, the data, the facts, and also, you know, reach people like you who are going to publicize this.
Brad Adams right there, founder and executive director of Climate Rights International, joining us from Kuala Lumpur. Appreciate you taking time out to join us this noon. Take care.
Thank you.